Before we start off this morning, I'm going to read from our main text that a friend sent to me last week. And in the light of where our nation is right now, I have really felt compelled and led by the Holy Spirit to preach a prophetic message for us as a church. And I come to you today in fear and trembling because I want to get this message right before God. But I trust that before this message is over, there's going to be a match lit in all of our hearts to see God's will come to pass in our lives and in our nation. We turn to Joel chapter 2, and I'm going to read from verse 12. Yet even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and he relents over disaster. Last week we watched in horror as trucks were set alight, roads were closed, shopping malls looted, the biggest port in Africa closed down and ceased to operate for a while, and many people lost their lives as a result of the violence. This is going to have a major impact on our economy, on the psyche of the nation, on international investors and their confidence in our nation. And not only that, it's going to may play a very big role in the plight of the poor as well. And during all the tensions, we saw ethnic and racial tensions, political divisions, all these things rearing their ugly head. It would be insincere to say that last week was not bad. It was really bad. For some people, this came as a great surprise. How could this have happened? We didn't see it coming. And for others, they are saying, we have seen this coming for many, many years. When you look at the tinderbox that is in South Africa with so much inequality, so much hatred across the board. And this morning, I really feel led to preach a prophetic message for us as Junction Church. Because in this time, we need to ask ourselves, is there hope for our nation? Is there hope for our community? And this is the title of my message this morning. There is hope for South Africa because you live here. Because the church is here, there is hope for our nation. So let's not get distracted by so many different camps trying to sow division. If ever there was a great time to be alive as a believer, it is today. And the nation needs us more than ever before, and here we are. But the question that you and I need to answer is this: what does it mean for you and I to be part of the church? What does it even mean to be part of Junction Church? Do you know what? For some people, maybe church is just a place or a building where I come to have my social needs met. And for other people, they might say, you know what? I come to a Sunday service so that I can have my conscience cleared and I can go along with my life and make sure that I do it in a bit of a better mood. And for other people, they say the church is a place where I come to have my needs met. Now, for sure, the community of believers and gathering together does play some of those roles, but surely that is just a small start. Being the church, and the church is so much more than that. And let's look at what Peter tells us about who we actually are. And he says the following: as you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. The church is clearly not a building. It is made up of people. It is a spiritual house. It is you and I. But for what purpose are we the spiritual house? For what purpose are we the church? And Peter continues and he says this: but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. This is who we are. We are one, the body of Christ. We are called to be the light in the world. In fact, we are the only hope of the world because of the message that we carry and the Spirit of God living in us. And especially in this time, let's not fall into the trap of being divided along our political affiliations, along our racial makeup, along our economic situation that we might find ourselves in when it comes to our brothers and sisters in Christ. We are one. And let's be honest, it's not the one thing that we have in common, the most important of all, a people collectively forged together by the blood of Jesus Christ, so that we can be cleansed together, stand together, and do what God has called us to do. Do you know what we are? The church. And in this fight to see God's will take place here in this nation, we are not fighting against one another. The church are the people that you are fighting for and that you are fighting with to be able to do the very things that God has called us to do. And so in these coming weeks, we're going to be sharing a series that we've entitled Arise and Build. To arise and build in our community as Junction Church, to arise and build in our nation, to arise and build and fulfill the calling individually that God has placed on your life, because that encourages all of us. And so I'm going to share a quote from the Prime Minister of South Africa in the 1930s and 40s, Jan Smuts. Now, I don't know whether you agreed with his politics or you disagreed with his politics, whether you love them as an individual or you despise them as an individual, but in this quote that we find in one of his letters, I think that he was very accurate. And he said, "In South Africa, the best or the worst never happens. Throughout our history, and regardless of our many problems, South Africa is still revered in Africa. And so many people across the world look at South Africa with hope because so many people predicted the absolute worst for this nation, and it never, ever happened. Yet on the other hand, regardless of our great triumphs and all of our successes, we never seem to kick on to everything God has in store for us, with so many people left behind in poverty, being destitute, corruption, and violence and division. Aren't you tired of seeing this? Aren't you tired of seeing people struggle in poverty, or maybe you're in poverty yourself? Aren't you tired of the violence and the corruption and the racism and the divisions and the corporate scandals in our nation? I'm sure you are tired of it. I sure am. And you know what, it is true that the Bible says that in the last days the wickedness will increase, but that is not a license for us to think that we can passively sit back and the world is happening to us. No, the Lord has called us to actively be the people that change the world. Let's not bemoan the lack of moral values in our society and bemoan and remember the good old days. Is it not us who have been called to go out and see people saved and the communities transformed by the Spirit of God? Let's not think for one moment that our only recourse in this world is to vote, even though we appreciate the privilege. We are the light of the world. We are the city on the hill that draws people to the light and sees a society transform. Why am I so taken by the message of the prophet Joel? Because Because when I read the story that is in there, it reminds me so much of where we are at as a nation and how we can apply many of these things for us right now. Now, the prophet Joel writes to the people of Judah, the kingdom of Judah, and the capital city, Jerusalem. But what's interesting about this book is, as theologians, we don't have a definitive timeline of these events. There is no date mentioned, there is no king mentioned, so we don't have the full context of the events that are mentioned. But regardless, even though we don't have the full context, the message is so vital, because in this book, there is a key lesson that we can apply in our nation today that could very well be the match that is lit, that is needed to see communities transformed. So the prophet Joel starts off and he writes about a plague of locusts that have come in swarms all the time, and it has ravaged the nation. Now, this could speak about a physical plague of locusts that have ravaged the economy by taking out all the agriculture. Or in ancient texts, very often the locust is spoken about as swarms of armies that come against you. So maybe it was a marauding army that came upon them. But regardless, when I read it, I just felt the parallels connected to our own nation today, where the enemy, the devil, has come to steal and loot so much from our nation. So many people in poverty, the racism, the divisions, the violence, all of these things that the devil has used for decades, and a lot of it culminating on our TV screens last week, seeing so many people loot those shopping malls. But you know what? So many of those looters have had their own lives looted and destroyed, and their dignity stolen by the devil himself. Remember, our fight is not against flesh and blood, but against the powers and the principalities in the heavenly realms. That is what Paul tells us. How can we play a role for every person to bring back dignity? That is the job of the church. But Joel doesn't end with the locusts. After the locusts had come, Joel says it's because of the people hardening their hearts and turning away from God. And now there is a second army coming against them. It is the judgment of God now coming in its fullness against the people. So many people have predicted and prophesied about South Africa being completely destroyed. About South Africa once and for all experiencing the worst. But what I love about this book in Joel is that even though the judgment of God is coming and Joel is warning the people, the Lord shows Joel that his judgment is still conditional upon the repentance of people. And as they turn their hearts toward him, he can turn around and pour blessing upon those people. Let's catch up our main text again. Yet even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and he relents over disaster. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Before we dissect this passage, I want to warn each and every one of us. This message is not for your business partner. It is not for the looter that you saw on television. This message is not for your political opponent. And this message is not for your lukewarm, wealthy, nominal Christian friend living in the suburbs. This message is for you and for me. We need to return to a place where we give our hearts to the Lord anew in everything that we are doing. If we have fallen into a lukewarm, comfort-seeking Christianity, coming to church just trying to hear a message and leave in a better mood, maybe it's time that we no longer have business as usual, but step into the call that God has for us and He's always had for us. Maybe it's not so much for others to repent, but it is for us to repent as the church, and that is maybe the starting point for revival in this nation. If there is sin in our lives that has kept us away from God's favor upon us to fulfill His call, maybe today is the day that we repent and rid ourselves of the shackles of the things that keep us back. And I remind us of John Wesley, who said the following: "Give me 100 men who fear nothing but sin and desire nothing but God, and I care not whether they be clergymen or laymen, they alone will shake the gates of hell and set up the kingdom of heaven upon the earth." I'm going to focus on those famous words that we find in Joel chapter 2. "Rend your hearts and not your garments." What was the Lord meaning when He said these words? In the Jewish culture, when you went through a time of mourning, when you went through a time of repentance, you would tear your clothing as an outward sign of your heartbreak, of your mourning, of your repentance before God. And what the Lord is saying here to us in South Africa as believers: wait, I'm not asking you for an outward sign of your devotion. I'm asking you for an inward change where your heart is completely sold out to me and my call and my will. We can raise our hands in church and we can say amen to the preacher, and we can have a Jesus t-shirt, and we can have a little band that says, "What would Jesus do?" And we can have a bumper sticker on our car with a Christian message or a scripture. But in the end, if there is no inward change in all of us, this is just a sham. If only we could be a people whose hearts are completely and utterly devoted to the kingdom of God. The sky is the limit for what God can do in us and through us in this nation. And as Joel speaks about the locusts that had come, and he speaks about the judgment of God that was coming to the people, they repented, rent their hearts, and the Lord took pity upon them as they turned their hearts towards Him. And He started to bless their land. He started to give them abundance. His judgment was delayed and stayed because they started in a place of repentance. Now, obviously, this book of Joel has got many prophetic connotations regarding the end times and other nations. Not enough time to even speak about some of that today, but the basic message remains the same. Here we are in South Africa as believers, called to stand up, called to make a difference. Maybe the greatest place for us to start is in a place of repentance and wholehearted devotion to our King. When that happens, hope arises in us. Creativity arises in us. Evangelism arises in us as we want to reach people. We are no longer passive, but active participants in advancing the kingdom of God, and this nation will be blessed. May we be a people that arise and build. In the coming weeks, as we preach, we're going to try to unpack some of the more practical areas of how we can actually live this out in our community. Hopefully soon we're going to be able to meet together again. If ever there was a time for us to start to meet together again, it is now, because our community needs us more than ever. And as we start to meet together, I'm going to challenge you with this: in these coming weeks, repent and come to the Lord and say, "God, what is it that You've placed upon my life, and how can I make a difference in our community?" And as you think about that, when we meet together again, we can start to spur one another on, throw ideas together on how we can live out the kingdom of God in our city and in our nation. A real low-hanging fruit that I want to introduce you to over the next few weeks is our Jesus Cares campaign. Very, very simple. Why don't you help us by donating food, donating blankets and clothes, loving your community by sharing encouraging words with them, praying with people, just being there, loving on people. And why don't you share your testimony? And why don't you take the time and come and share those testimonies with us so that we can all be inspired together about what God is doing. I am not coming back after lockdown for business as usual. And I trust and believe neither are you coming back for a time of business as usual. I want to see all of us play a role in this nation. This is what God has called us to do. What has God placed upon your heart? Think about that. Pray about that. There is hope in South Africa because you live here. Let's arise and build. As we consider the message this morning, I want to remind all of us that the starting point of this journey to arise and build in our nation and in our communities starts at the foot of the cross. We remember what Jesus did for us when he died on the cross and was raised from the dead. And not only that he offers the forgiveness of your sins and eternal life if we but believe in the gospel message. And so today, for those of you that have never accepted Christ, maybe today is the start of your journey. But also, for those of you that are believers, that is why we take communion, the bread and the cup, so that we can always remember what Christ has done for us. Join us on Zoom today. We'll be having communion together. For those of you that cannot join our Zoom call, make sure that you have communion often to remember what Christ did for us. The gospel message never gets old.
You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. Is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city, you're the King of this people, you're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like I. There is no one like our God. no one like our God. There is no one like you, God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to